So I want to tell you about a nice girl that I know.
Okay.
I know a nice girl.
Uh-huh.
She's really a brilliant girl. Very smart.
Oh.
And I was with her one time, and, well, there was somebody else in the room.
Uh-huh.
And the other person was carrying on about all of her accomplishments and accolades and just the great things she had ever done in her life. And I'm thinking, come on, nice girl. Come on, say something. You've done stuff. You've done some stuff. Come on. You've done stuff. Come on.
Oh, my gosh. Oh my gosh.
So finally, I had to say, you know, my nice girl over here has done some pretty cool stuff. Lois P. Frankel is on the phone. She's got a book called Nice Girls Don't Speak Up or Stand Out. That's why they have to have a friend like Larry.
That's right.
Although maybe the point of the book is to get you to change your mind about that behavior. Lois is the president of Corporate Coaching International. She's a speaker for business coaching and empowerment of women, a member of the Washington Speakers Bureau, and we're proud to say a guest on this show. Good morning, Lois Frankel. It's an honor to have you on the show.
Larry and Robin, thank you so much for having me. Oh, it's a pleasure to be with you.
Oh, what a great voice you have, by the way. Do you do the voice on the audiobook?
I absolutely do.
Well, good.
Yes, I do.
I like hearing that. So are you a nice girl? Did this happen to you? Were you this person?
I am a nice girl in recovery. You know, I think once you're a nice girl, you never quite get over it. And so I have to tell myself often to do the things that I recommend to others. I mean, I really want to walk the talk, obviously.
Yeah.
But I was brought up to be a nice girl, you know, to not make any waves and to work hard and to, you know, be kind to others and to take care of others. And, you know, I still do all those things. I just have to remind myself to do the things you were talking about at the top of this interview, which is also speak up for myself and illuminate my strengths and my accomplishments.
One of the unbecoming things that men do, and at a group of, let's just say a party, just to make it easy, is they will brag about their accomplishments. It's very unbecoming, I think. And so I wonder if maybe women see that, and either A, they don't want to compete, or B, they don't want to look like that, because it is unbecoming to be bragging about yourself.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, there's a continuum of self-aggrandizement, isn't there? On one end, you have Donald Trump, who can't stop bragging about himself.
right? Yeah.
And then on the other hand, you have somebody like Sally Field, where when she won the Academy Award, said, oh, you like me, you really like me.
Right.
And so she wasn't self-aggrandizing enough. And there's a place in the middle that is really healthy, because we have to be able to illuminate our accomplishments for people to know that we have achieved something. Otherwise, they don't know. But you're absolutely right. It's not appealing to listen to someone talk, whether it's a man or a woman, talk about how they're the best at everything.
Yeah, I think you're right. But at the same time, and you were absolutely right, I hear what you're saying, because you don't want to go either extreme. You want to, especially if you're trying to move ahead, like let's say in your job. I know men and women who have been shy, I'll just use that word, shy, and they are more capable of doing the job that somebody else got, but because they don't, you know, they don't kind of shine their own light. They stay in that one place. And it is something I think I've noticed.
What we know is that men are good at showcasing their confidence. Women focus more on showcasing their competence. Right? So what women believe is that if I'm competent and I do a good job, I'll get noticed, when that's not true, because there's a lot of people who do a good job and who are competent, and they don't get promoted. The people who get promoted are the ones who promote themselves a little bit.
That's
As a matter of fact, you know, I'm not here to talk about somebody else's book, but in the sake of fairness, a woman by the name of Peggy Klaus wrote a great book that I wish I wrote, and it's called Brag, The Art of Tooting Your Own Horn Without Blowing It. And we all need to learn how to do that a little bit more. And I do take some of her ideas, and I give her credit in Nice Girls Don't Speak Up or Stand Out.
And what you do so eloquently is you do stress the communication part.
Absolutely. You know, when it comes to showcasing my capabilities, it is all about communication, isn't it? And let me just give you one example. One of the things I talk about in the book is mansplaining. And that's when men explain to women things that they already know. And a lot of times women will just sit there and listen to it or stand there and listen to it as if this is what I have to do. Well, that's a perfect place to showcase your capabilities and to just interject with something like, you know, excuse me a second here. You probably didn't realize that I have a PhD in counseling psychology. I've written 8 books and that I'm on the bestseller list. Now, if you did realize that, I'm sure you wouldn't talk to me like that. Right now, there's a lot of, in that case, you know, because I was doing it on the fly, I might have sounded a little strident, but you could use humor with it too.
No, you're right. You're absolutely right. But Lois, I'm going to defend men just for a second here, okay? I'm not going to deny what you said because you're absolutely right, but I don't think men mansplain only to women. Men mansplain to each other too.
Yes, they do. They do, isn't it? You know.
Oh yeah.
There's a name for that I don't want to say on the radio, but you're absolutely
right.
Oh
really? Because my comeback is always, do I look like I never was living on Earth before? Mm-hmm. I mean, did I just come here?
You're right, and you know, for both men and women who are familiar with basketball terms, you know the hip check, right? Have you heard of that, the hip check?
No, I don't know that one. Tell me.
Yeah, when somebody gets in your territory and you're on the basketball field, you kind of give them a little, you hit them a little bit with your hip to let them know, hey, look, I know that you're there.
Okay, gotcha. Okay? Right, yeah.
And we can give verbal hip checks. You know, a verbal hip check is just exactly what I just did then. You know, excuse me a second, you probably didn't realize this, but, you know, there's a verbal hip check. You know, you got to let people know you're there.
Well, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, I think you're right. And you know who stands up for women the most is their fathers and brothers. And maybe their husbands, if they're smart. You know what I mean? So, I don't know.
Yeah, husbands who are not intimidated by a woman's greatness, they absolutely do. And I see it a lot with dads, particularly these days. At the end of a keynote, you know, the dads who come up to me and say, oh, you know, I can't wait to share this with my daughter because she's so competent and I want her to achieve everything. Absolutely. And you know what? To some degree, bosses, you know, I had this wonderful boss 30 years ago. He happened to have been a professional football player before he went into business. It was the best advocate I ever had. Didn't have to ask him to do anything. Always advocating for me. And so I think women need to also expect and look for and ask for those kinds of advocates.
Now, the difference between men and women, sometimes when men need to get a point across, they get loud, and that's very effective. When women try to get a point across and they get loud, to me it's not effective because it's so screechy. It's just there's got to be a better way for women to express their points than to try being screechy like that.
You're absolutely right, Robin. Women walk a thin pink line. It was a term coined by Kathleen Kelly Reardon. Women walk a thin pink line all the time. If I go too far over the line in one direction, I'm seen as screechy and arrogant and strident. If I go too far over the line in the other direction, I'm seen as a doormat. So I need to be able to find the ways and the language to use that keeps me on that line where I maintain relationships, but I also maintain my authenticity. And that's really what I tried to do in this book. And that's why this book is audio. Because when I started writing it, I realized this doesn't translate to the written word. I need to make this audio. Women need to hear what does it sound like to walk that thin pink line.
That's interesting. With that said, if I could, I think I can play a sample from the audio listing on Amazon. The book is called Nice Girls Don't Speak Up or Stand Out, How to Make Your Voice Heard, Your Point Known, and Your Presence Felt. It's written by Dr. Lois P. Frankel, and it's actually an audiobook, and it's voiced by you, right? You're the voice?
Mm-hmm.
So let me push this button.
I am the voice.
Let's see if I can hear a sample in here.
Then there's the going along to get along, doing things you don't really want to do, but you don't want to rock the boat. That's the essence of being a nice girl. Someone who always puts everyone else's needs before her own, who believes she doesn't have the same rights as the next person, and who will do everything possible to avoid being called the B word.
Wait. That's Robin. You just described Robin right there. That was Robin. Robin is that way. Talk to Robin. She needs some help.
Robin, we need to get you into recovery, don't we?
Yeah, there we go. Well, you know, there's this election year coming up. And after Trump was elected and everything, I'm not picking on the party because I support, whoever is president is president. But then everybody was screaming they need women leaders, they need women in the office and all of that stuff. But they're never following through. They had the hashtag Me Too movement and everything, and all of these women were coming out of the woodwork. But, you know, I really don't see those same women's movements selecting one woman or two women to run for the presidency. They're just not verbal anymore. I just don't understand how come they can say things and then all of a sudden they never follow through, which I think is a shame.
You know, it really is a shame, and I just had the same conversation with some friends over the weekend. They were talking about the women's marches and how they changed things, and I said, no, they didn't. Mm-hmm. I said, those women's marches didn't change things. Look, it's 3 years later, and we're in their exact same position we were in before. And so what we really need to do is put our money where our mouths are. And my suggestion was, being who I am, as I said, I wish I could get a million women to join me in Washington, D.C., and to sit in the streets and not leave, because you can't arrest a million of us, until we really get some attention paid to the issues that are important, on both sides of the aisle, because I'm not pointing fingers at either side. We're in a stalemate, and it's only women who are going to get us out of this stalemate, because women don't play the game of mine is bigger than yours, right? Mm-hmm. Women play the game of let's fix the problem. And that's all I'm focusing on, and that's why I believe we need more women in leadership right now. And absent that, we're going to stay stuck.
And those women aren't coming forward. I mean, all of those women that were vocal, those actresses and those artists and the multimillionaires that were all vocal and got their faces on the front part of the news and on the papers, none of them are coming forward.
Well, you know, some of them are actually, I went to a lecture the other night, and it happened to be with Lily Tomlin and Jane Fonda. And Jane Fonda was talking about the fact that she gets arrested every Friday because her thing is climate change. So she protests every Friday in Washington, and she said, I moved to Washington so that I keep getting arrested because I want to bring attention to climate change. But, you know, she can't do it alone. We have to develop a critical mass. And that's why I said, I wish I could get a million women to join me and just sit and stay and stop what's going on. And I mean literally stop government, because that's all that's going to change things. Because if you look around the world, look at the Arab Spring. Look at how the critical mass there really changed society fundamentally. And we as Americans, we're a little bit too fat and happy. And you're absolutely right, Robin. We're not putting it out there. It's a little bit like the difference between the chicken and the pig, right? They're both asked to bring something to breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
Who's more committed? Who's more committed? You know, the chicken or the pig? So, yeah, I agree with you.
But then you hear Alyssa Milano and Rose McGowan. They're the young ones, and they should be out there because Jane Fonda's too old, Lily Tomlin's too old. But you got to have the young ones getting involved, and they're the ones making noise. Then when it comes down to it, to make them step up to the plate, they won't do it.
Well, you know, we don't have a person who's galvanizing everyone. That's part of the problem. We need, you know, any great movement has someone to galvanize them. Look at the civil rights movement. There was Martin Luther King, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, look at the women's movement early. There was Elizabeth Cady Stanton. There was Susan B. Anthony. Look at Rosa Parks. There were people who galvanized, and we don't have that person who's galvanizing.
I want to bring something up there, listening to you ladies talk. You're naming people who are the exception to what the book is about. All of the people you name, whether you agree or disagree with their politics, they all are speaking up and standing out. So I think the book is more for the wallflower who is not, the one who has something to offer, and something to say, it's not about agreeing or disagreeing with the person. It's about allowing that voice to be heard. We've come a long way as far as allowing everybody to be heard. We still have, you know, probably we could argue a way to go, but at least everybody can be heard. And I think your book speaks to women who have something to say but are holding back. The women you just named all step forward. They're all speaking up.
Mm-hmm. But they're not doing anything, really. They're not committing themselves.
I hear what you're saying, but her point is...
Now, we need that galvanizing, but we also need, as Larry said, more people who have the tools to be able to do it. You know, you can't, you know, if you knew better, you'd do better. You can't do what you don't know how to do. And that was really the purpose of my book, is that, by profession, I'm an executive coach. I teach people how to look and sound like an actor on a corporate stage. And there is a look and there is a sound to it. And in this book, I'm really focusing on the sound. As a matter of fact, the working title of the book, which most people don't know because nobody ever talks about that, my working title, and I pitched it to Hachette as The Nice Girl's Guide to Telling People to Go to Hell So They Look Forward to the Trip.
There you go.
Right? Because isn't that really what we have to do? Mm-hmm. We have to tell people things they don't want to hear, but that they need to hear, or we need them to hear it, and not damage any relationships. And that's what the book is filled with. It is filled with tools and tips for how to do that. Things from, just contrasting, saying what I do want or I don't want, saying something like, Robin, I don't want you to think that I'm not agreeing with what you say, because I absolutely do agree. People aren't putting their money where their mouth is. At the same time, I believe we need to have a galvanizing person behind which we can all align. Now, that's one way for me to be able to say to you what I'm really thinking, right?
Exactly. You do it so eloquently.
I think there are some there are some women who do speak up about what they say. You know, what's interesting is if you have, let's say, a talk show host. We have a lady, she's not here, but she's on the network that we run, Dana Lesh. She's extreme. She's very conservative, very powerful, very outspoken, but yet also very criticized. So men and women in this sense are in the same boat. If you speak up, you will not have everybody agreeing with you. And I think part of what holds people back is the fear of being disagreed with and the fear of having pressure put against you. Look at the ladies on The View. I mean, they don't all agree, but they are learning how to voice their opinions so that the rest of us can kind of, chew it out and agree or disagree. There's a lot of what they say that I don't agree with, but I applaud them for having the courage to say it. And as a dad who doesn't want a daughter to be a wallflower, but rather shine because she's brilliant, that I love what your book is saying. I love the core message of your book because of that.
Thank you, Larry, because you've really got the essence of it then, because that is what I want women to be able to do. I want them to be able to shine and to put it out there and to disagree without being disagreeable. But you're also absolutely right that we don't do that often enough because we're afraid. And I think both men and women do this. I mean, when I look at Washington, and I'm not talking about just, one party or the other, but look at Washington and why we're at a gridlock, because members of people on both sides of the aisle are afraid to speak the truth. They are afraid to speak truth to power because they're either going to be put down by their own party or their constituents, and as a result, we're moving nowhere. So there's this fear that does go along with saying what needs to be said, and yet, I'm kind of the belief, what's my choice? I'm either part of the problem or I'm part of the solution. And I don't mean globally, although it's true globally, I also mean on a personal level. I can't complain that I'm not making enough money if I'm not willing to go to my boss or the powers that be and say, hey, listen, here's why I deserve more money, and then make a business case for it. If I'm afraid I'm not going to be liked for it or I might be fired, I'm never going to step up, and nothing's ever going to change.
Yeah,
well said.
Absolutely. And as somebody who has written books and pushed, produced audiobooks, etc. I mean, you are taking your own life and doing something without waiting for somebody else to do it for you. It's all good if you think about it in that way. I think when you say that the people in Washington don't speak the truth, I think many of them speak what they believe is the truth. The one thing we as Americans have to recognize, though, is what is true. And what's always true is that it's pretty true that everybody's always in it for their own selves. It's hard to. My dad told me never to trust anyone, and I approach the world that way. And then of course I do trust people anyway, but it's just the way it is. Lois, let's see. The book is again called "Nice Girls Don't Speak Up or Stand Out." Well, maybe the book will change that. I found it on Amazon. You're doing really well, by the way, on Amazon, and you have other books as well, right?
I do. This is actually the fourth in the series of Nice Girls books. There was Nice Girls Don't Get the Corner Office, Nice Girls Don't Get Rich, Nice Girls Don't Get It, and now Nice Girls Don't Speak Up and Stand Out. So there are four Nice Girls books, and then there are a number of other books that I've written, which for some reason haven't done as well, and I think they're just as good.
You're always supportive in the context of the book. You're never condescending. You're always making sure that women should just look within themselves, find what they're good at, and just push forward.
That I don't want people to be who they're not. That is never the goal. The goal is to be your best self, to start with your strengths, but then identify what do you have to add to your toolkit to be even more successful. It's a little, you know, I like to bake bread. Mm-hmm. And so I always have in my kitchen all the ingredients I need for baking bread. And so once I have the basic ingredients, I can bake any kind. I can change it. I could put cheese in it. I could put, you know, honey in it. I could put all kinds of things, right? Mm-hmm. It's the same thing when it comes to communication and to getting the things that you want. You have to start with the basics, you know, and that's who you are, and you're really good at it. And then you have to add some things that are going to make it special, because every person is special. Well, how are you going to illuminate that? It, you know, kind of goes back to what we were talking about before. How are you going to, you know, toot your own horn without blowing it?
I like that a lot. So who is the person that you think is doing this the best? Who is somebody we would know, I guess. I can think of some. Like you mentioned Jane Fonda, whether you like her or not, she has the courage to stand up and speak. Dolly Parton has the courage to speak. Dana Lash has the courage to speak. Margaret Thatcher, right? She had the courage to speak. So there are some examples, right?
Oh, there absolutely are. As you look around the world, Angela Merkel. She's somebody I really admire for her ability to speak the truth and still be likable. Julia Gillard, who used to be the Prime Minister of Australia, another woman who really put it out there clearly. And I talk about this in the book, if you can Google her misogyny speech. Just Google Julia Gillard, G-I-L-L-A-R-D, misogyny speech, and you'll see her really speaking truth to power. Somebody I also talk about in the book is Nancy Pelosi. You know, if you take one snippet of what Nancy Pelosi did a year ago, December, when she looked at Donald Trump and she said to him, "Mr. President, I would appreciate it if you would not mischaracterize what I can and cannot do." It was a perfect communication that showed respect and at the same time got her point across. I think she's a good role model in many ways.
But I have something to say, not about that, but about politics in general, is that what you just described is what men do to each other. Because that they're playing a game. It's a game. And the fact that she's female doesn't change anything. If Nancy was a man, Donald Trump would have said the same exact stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think it's a game that they play. And that's why I don't trust any of it. I think it's all a game. Because after they get out of office, they're playing golf.
That's true too, and it is a game. And I agree with you that he would have said the same thing, but I think a guy could have shot back with, "Oh, come on, you know that's not true." If Nancy Pelosi did that, she would be put down. And see, that's the same line that women. Yeah, it's not that. It's not that.
That's true.
Politicians treat men differently than women. It's about how we get to respond.
You know, that is a really true point. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely true. Good. That was a good comeback. I like that, Lois. Thank you for that. All right. Nice girls.
You're welcome, Larry.
Don't speak up or stand out, except for Lois. She's a nice girl, and she's standing out right now. So the audiobook is online. Any other websites we should go to?
Yeah, go to my website, drloisfrankel.com, and that's drloisfrankel.com. And if you let me know through the website, and if you click on the new book tab at the top of the homepage, it'll take you to a page where you can find ways to buy the book. But if you let me know that you bought the book, I will send you a free companion workbook that you'll only get if you heard me say this on your show.
All right. And one little asterisk, I think men can learn a lot from this, too, because there are a lot of wallflower men that need to speak up as well. Thank you, Lois. Dr. Frankel, thank you, doctor.
Thank you both so much. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you. We'll be right back.
I'm Mark Sears with Regency Printing. With over 10 years in the printing business, I know you'll find Regency Printing the place for all your local printing needs. Plus, I have back services, mailbox rentals, notary service, U.S. mail, pack and ship, all at one convenient location, 2375 Northeast 25th Avenue. Just look for the yellow signs. Regency Printing, 789-6683. That's 789-6683. Regency Printing.
Garden announces Fast Track. Fast Track. Focused assessment, safe transition. When a new guest is admitted to Palm Garden, we start with the ABCs. A is the assessment to determine what the guest needs. B is for basic care, which is excellent nursing and therapy. And C is for consistency to provide what's needed throughout the stay. Fast Track. Palm Garden will get you home fast, really, really fast. Take a fast tour of Palm Garden located at the corner of Southwest 27th Avenue and 34th Street.
Direct Connect to UCF, where students who attend the College of Central Florida and graduate with an AA or articulated AS degree are guaranteed admission to the University of Central Florida. Success coaches are ready and waiting to assist you in designing an educational plan that is right for you in any of their locations across Central Florida. Remember, connecting is easy and guaranteed. Find out more at directconnecttouCF.com.
Jean Powell, Pastor Shemoy. Jean and Debbie, thank you for another successful year and to wish you peace, love, and joy in 2020. Now is the perfect time to fence row spray for weed control, rototilling for your winter gardens, and stump grinding. We are family-owned and operated, licensed and insured, and farm-ready. Powell Jean, G-E-N-E, at yahoo.com, 352-629-2440. Jean Powell, Pastor Shemoy, 352-629-2440. Jean is a proud United States veteran.